I'm not sure we've got, I mean, the Boston, I guess my point is the Boston bombing happened, even though they kept taking away securities and freedoms and stuff like that to try to make us safer, and things like that continue to happen. You're not going to stop that. So what's the point of taking away everybody's freedoms? So when you were looking into the Boston bombing, what was the part of the story that made the least sense, or the part where was there a giant hole that you're like, okay, something about this doesn't necessarily make sense?
Well, I mean, I have to say that as an investigative journalist, I rely a lot on a kind of a sixth sense about things. And that is not just really an imaginary thing. It comes from experience. You've seen enough things, you've read enough things, and you see patterns. And right when the bombing happened, I actually got a bad feeling beyond just the bad feeling you get from the bombing itself. I immediately thought the symbolism of it, the Boston Marathon, Patriots Day, Tax Day, you know, it all happened. All these factors came together, and then a bomb went off. And so my first thought was, whatever's behind this, they either lucked out or they were aware of the tremendous sort of trifecta of symbolism. And so that struck me. And that's just, I think, rational way of looking at something as soon as it happens, that you could say that these people were aware of the symbolism there, as opposed to planting a bomb in a shopping center in Omaha on, you know, some random Saturday. I mean, there's a big difference. So that struck me right away, and I wanted to know, therefore, what that symbolism was about. Now, if you think about it, we are told this is Islamic terrorism, and yet the first thing that occurred to me was, well, what do Islamic terrorists do? Well, number one, they become martyrs. So they don't fear death. They cause death in others, and then they basically they themselves die. So that didn't happen here. Nobody that we know of, no perpetrator died directly after this dramatic event. The second thing I thought of is that what they always do is they're looking for the symbolism, and they're looking to make a political statement. That's almost always the case. I mean, Charlie Hebdo and so on. What was the political statement they made here? There was none. There was no political statement made. These people who, I'm going to still use the term alleged because I believe a lot has not come out yet. But in any case, these people the older brother was not tried, but so I'll use the term alleged. But anyway, these alleged perpetrators were at the marathon bombing. We know that from video. And we know that they then went on with their lives like everybody else at the thing who was not injured, you know. The older brother went back to his wife and kid in Cambridge, and the younger brother went back to his college dorm. They even stopped to buy milk right after it. In fact, they not only bought milk, but then the younger brother came back into the store to exchange it for another milk. You know, very, very odd. Not the normal behavior of Islamic fundamentalists. But the key point is they never claimed credit for this. And they didn't act in any way, shape, or form like the prototypical Islamic fundamentalist terrorist. And so it doesn't fit. That's the first thing. The second thing is that the FBI put up pictures of these two guys shown wearing backpacks, and they said these are subjects of interest. Does anyone know who they are? So my first thought is, why are they subjects of interest? What is it about two young guys wearing backpacks in a video at a public event with presumably hundreds if not thousands of people with backpacks? So I didn't get why they thought they were of interest. Now, the third thing was that within days of that, a report came out in the Russian media, some sort of a leak from the Russian security forces, that the Russians knew who these brothers were. And furthermore, that the Russians had previously notified the Americans of these people prior to the bombings. And then the FBI was forced to admit that they had hid that fact or forgotten that, which is really preposterous. And they were forced to admit that, yes, the Russians had told them. And that, in fact, yes, they had checked them out as possible terrorists, and that they had interacted with the elder brother and the family and concluded that he was no threat. Now, how is that not front and center of what we're talking about in this case, because even in the best case scenario, it means that the FBI is no good.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you're absolutely right. How do they, I mean, I have the same friend that's a police officer. I brought that up to him, and he did say that sometimes you investigate something and then you see nothing there and then you move on, and then it's possible that something could happen afterwards. You know, they could become extremists or whatnot afterwards. I mean, I guess that is one side.
Well, of course. But you can't just have outfits like the FBI with the power and the money and everything they have and just let them off like that. You know, it's, we're not talking about a child who spilled something, you know. Yeah. I mean, this is an outfit, as you point out, they were able to shut down an entire American city and suspend our civil liberties, and that your cop friend is not even slightly curious, or that there are no consequences or no investigations or no recriminations or no heads roll, that your cop friend doesn't even occur to him that maybe if somebody, pardon my French, screws up that big, that there ought to be some kind of result to that, that there ought to be some kind of investigation and something ought to be fixed. The fact that these people are so clueless as to not even understand that, you know, if you discover that the babysitter is a pedophile, you don't go, well, okay, you know, whatever. I mean, you don't, and you should not do that in an instance like this. So that's just baloney. And at our website, Who, What, Why, we have done almost 80 articles about the Boston Marathon bombing. That's about 80 more investigative pieces than any of your news organizations, including the Boston Globe or anybody else. There was no serious attempt to investigate the holes in the story. They could have done a 10-part series just on how the FBI screwed up, how it happened, who screwed up, why, what changes they have made, whether there were any kind of there was any kind of punishment meted out against the people responsible. I mean, why was there none of that? Why was there no discussion? Why was there no investigation? Now, the third thing on that front, or I don't know, I've lost count, is that it turns out that the FBI was in contact with Tamerlan Tsarnaev before the Russians tipped them off. Before. Now, we are the only people to report this. Again, if you go to whowhatwhy.org and you go in our search box and put in Tsarnaev, T-S-A-R-N-A-E-V, and you'll get a lot of articles, but somewhere in there you'll find articles on that particular point. The FBI had a prior relationship with the elder brother. Now, once you know that, and you're not willing, and you see how nobody was punished, you start saying, well, if nobody was punished for either gross incompetency or something else, and there was a secret prior relationship with the brother, don't you think we ought to wonder if we're missing something here?
Yeah. And there's that video. I don't know what your conclusion is or what your opinion is on that video of that nude person being arrested that looked a lot like the older brother. But have you, I don't know if that was him or, but it certainly did look like him, and the built, you know, he's kind of built like him, you know, like an athlete, boxer. And what do you think happened to the older brother? I obviously there's conflicting stories with the brother ran him over or the cops ran him over after, you know, the trial and all the investigation and information you gathered. What do you think happened?
Well, I mean, we published an article fairly early on discussing the fact that the FBI routinely recruits foreign nationals, which is what the elder brother was, and put them into play as informants and provocateurs. This is a standard operating procedure. And even the New York Times, which didn't have the guts to investigate this thing, did publish a piece pointing out that out of 22 plots, 18 of them involved people being run by the FBI. Now, you know, hello. So, I mean, to not be interested in that, I mean, I really despair for this country, and I despair for the media. I despair for the so-called intellectual elites, because either we're like the stupidest people on earth or there's something else going on, because the fact that the kind of things that we've uncovered are not of interest to people and they continue to wave their flags and cheer. I mean, My God, we have no right to call ourselves, you know, talk about American exceptionalism and talk about how, you know, strut around and how superior we are in these, you know, these pathetic, you know, immigrants who want to come here. I mean, you know, honestly, this is just a complete and total abdication of common sense and of everything else. And so when I look at that story, I mean, there is a very high probability that if, as we know, the FBI had prior contact with Tamerlan Tsarnaev, that they did not simply go talk to him and ask him if he was a terrorist, which is what they claim. There's another article on our site, whowhatwhy.org, you can read. It was a special report by the inspectors general of a bunch of the major intelligence agencies. Now, that's not normal that they do this interagency report. That itself was special. When the report came out, it got very little attention, even though it was such a singular event. Much of what was in there was blacked out, so we can't even read it. And even what they didn't black out showed these inspectors general of these agencies themselves complaining that they were being stonewalled and prevented from knowing what was really going on. They ended up doing a whitewash because they had to, but they made very, very clear, and you didn't have to read too much between the lines, that they could see that there was a cover-up going on and they were being blocked. And so it seems to me that an open-minded, serious person, given the track record of the FBI in general, the pattern of recruiting infiltrators and provocateurs, fact of the documented FBI prior relationship with Tamerlan Tsarnaev, and then we add some other things. Tamerlan Tsarnaev was no sign of him being a radical. He was married to a blonde non-Muslim, although we are told she converted. I mean, he didn't fit the profile in any which way. We do know that around the time that he began to appear to be a radical, he was seeking to enter the Golden Gloves competition. He was a very gifted boxer, but he was told that to represent the United States in competitions, he had to be an American citizen. And so right at the moment that he needed to impress the American authorities with his patriotism, which is what that process is about, he begins acting like a radical Muslim and doing clumsy things and going into mosques and kind of yelling and seemingly provoking people. Now, it doesn't take a genius to put two and two together there.
Yeah, and see, you're hitting on a really, really important issue, and that's motive. You talk to any detective, you talk to any investigator, I mean, motive is one of the biggest things you look into, and the fact that a lot of these cases, the motive is still unclear. You know, it's not like you said, extreme radical who makes his motive very clear, you know, either, you know, a Confederate flag guy or a extreme Muslim who, you know, like you said, blows himself up, you know, and he thinks he's going to heaven and all these things. I mean, it's just, it doesn't seem like the typical extreme thinking extremist who has a clear motive and makes it obvious to the world. And I mean, it just seems kind of, I mean, it kind of seems like Jack Ruby, you know, like Jack Ruby. Oh, he killed Oswald because he was, you know, patriotic all of a sudden. I mean, this guy was a mobster and who, you know, obviously didn't give a shit about politics. So it was just, it just seemed like one of those things where just you're looking into motive, which I think is a really important point. And I think a lot of times we just kind of put that aside and kind of create our own motive. And I just think that that's something that we should look more into, because to do something as extreme as building bombs and killing three people, injuring many more, you would think that they were quite extreme, and it would be quite clear that they're quite extreme. And like you said, it doesn't seem like the picture all fits together correctly. Now, the other thing I wanted to ask you about was, I know you looked into, his name's not really Danny, but the Danny video, the kid who